Good morning, brothers and sisters. It's great to have you on board once again, and I do hope everyone is practicing safe distancing and wearing your mask, which gives respect to yourself and to others that the epidemic, the COVID epidemic, will not be spread. We are teaching the Word of God from the manuscripts, which is an original interpretation, and also from the Companion Bible, which is a version of the King James Version. The difference is it has scholar notes in it to help you to understand things a little more clear. And we just thank you again, and we just ask you to join in with us as we go through another lecture, and we invite you to bring your Bibles along and follow us as we follow Christ. All right, good morning to everyone. Hope everyone has had a pleasant week. And we're all here by the grace of God. And I think God has been good to us, whether we see all of the cracks and crevices that He has healed and brought us through. So we just thank Him for that today. Today, the sermon title is, What is Grace? What is grace? I don't know how much we focus in on that, you know, compared to whatever's going on in our lives. But getting through grace, which brings us through everything, it's His grace. We can praise Him, lift Him up, and thank Him, because it was only by grace that we got through what we got through. And sometimes we just get lackadaisia and don't always remember that at all. But we're going to start off with John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. His goal is that if we receive Him, what He has given to us, that we should not perish, and that the everlasting life that we have will be life with Him. Okay, sometimes we got to think out of the box. We got to think where we're headed, why we're doing what we're doing, because of the consequences. I believe the reason we are in the shape that the world is in, because too many of us don't believe and we don't pray, or to the hills, look to the hills from which cometh our help. Our help comes from the Lord. Now, following the history of God, when people that are called by His name did not believe, judgment was brought down upon them. I'm sorry to say, but at times the just have to suffer with the unjust. But God's grace is sufficient. Say that with me. He will take care of those who want to be taken care of, not those that are skimming along for a free ride. He wants us to be embedded in His Word, embedded in Him with faith, having faith that He dots His I's and crosses His T's. And sometimes we don't think He's seeing everything. We don't think He's understanding everything. But let me tell you something. If He was anything less, He wouldn't be God. It's not God forsaking and failing us, but it's us forsaking and failing God by not continuing to build our relationship. John chapter 15, verse 51. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I'm in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. Without me, you can do nothing. We have to understand that that he is the vine, we are the branches. Without him, we can do nothing. And this verse is not followed and not acknowledged enough. We always want to be our own resolution and our own solution to everything, rather than looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Romans chapter 5, verse 2. By whom also we have access by faith unto his grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Wisdom is knowledge. Everyone say wisdom is knowledge. Now, to be a success over all things, you must know the successor, which is Jesus Christ. And many of us want to pick and choose what wisdom we want, and it doesn't always get us where we want to be. And again, this lecture here is about grace, the power of grace, understanding grace, exercising grace, and letting grace work in our lives. And it's a different mindset. It's a different trend. When you get up in the morning, yes, 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 there's so many things going on in our lives to the point where we forget to pray. We forget to acknowledge. I like to go out on the deck in the morning with a cup of coffee and just sit out there and just look at the beautiful skies, the birds singing, and the glorious things that God has made. And you know what? Life sometime will rob us from finding the good, the joy in living on this earth. It's not always the greatest thing, but we have to find time. And when we find time, we find God, someone to rejoice in, someone to praise. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. And he said unto me, my grace, and this is Paul, my grace is sufficient for thee. God's grace is always sufficient for us. We may not like the way it feels, the way it seems, but let me tell you about the turnout. It generally turns out okay. And you want to know why it turns out okay? It's because God not only knows the beginning and the present, but he knows the end. He knows what's best for us. He knows what's best for us. And it goes on to say, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. When we are weak, that's when we're about to become strong. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, Paul says. In other words, I want to just understand that God understands and just let his power just roam through my life. And it goes on to say, he says, I'd rather glory in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. In other words, Lord, do what you got to do. And let me be a blessing to you, because I want you to be a blessing to me. Because I know not everything. I don't know everything. I want to. And glorify yourself through me. That's a big chunk of information to relate to God. Glorify yourself through me when you know things aren't going possibly the way that you want them to go. 1 Corinthians 15:10. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. I am what I am by the grace of God. He knows who we are. But be proud to be overcomers. That's the thing. Just as our forefathers, our prophets, they were proud to overcome and look forward to the next day or the next week or the next month. They were glad to look forward to that, because you know what they were doing? They were looking to see what God had in store for them. And sometimes we play the game of trying to be in control of everything. Now, God knows everything about you and I. You got to get that in your spirit. He knows everything about us. Listen to this. He was laying out the format for Jeremiah. And God said to Jeremiah in Jeremiah 1, chapter 1, verse 5, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb," as his mother's womb, "I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations." We didn't just end up here by mistake. Y'all didn't just end up here in Peru by mistake. God knew that's where you was headed when you left the first earth age in spirit. In spirit. And as he says, you come in and you come into the womb, your mother's womb, through water. Then you're born. And he knows what destination you're headed for. God knows who we are and who we're going to be and the choices we're going to make. He knows them. That's why we need to, by grace, ask him for leadership, guidance, and direction. Because he knows what we're about to get into. And when we pray and ask his guidance, let me tell you something. One day we're going to get into heaven and he's going to show us all the fatalities that was avoided because we called on his name and we asked him for guidance. Simple things. Simple things. Lord, where do you want me to work? Lord, where do you want me to live? Lord, where do you want me to shop? Lord, what church do you want me to go to? Lord, how do I raise my children? How do I raise my grandchildren? What input can I give on my grandchildren's behalf? Little things makes this journey a little bit easier. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10. "And his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain." Paul's acknowledging and realizing that the grace of God, may it lead me to different directions, is not in vain. "But I labored more abundantly than they all." In other words, I put forth the effort that I need to put forth. I gave all I needed to give, not giving up, not questioning, not hesitating, not pausing, not looking for somebody else's input. "But the grace of God which was with me." And you know, sometimes it gets difficult for us to acknowledge that the grace of God is with us when a lot of things are coming against us. And then we get feedback from people that call themselves our friends or relatives, whatever. It's hard to stay focused and centered and say, "Lord, I hear your voice. Lord, okay, this is where you want me to go." And just remember one thing, brothers and sisters. All of our successes should be credited to the Lord. If you want God's favor, credit God for where you've come from, where you're going, and where he wants you to be. Don't say, "Well, I did it my way." But say, "By the grace of God." That's all you have to say when you're talking to people and they're going, "Man, I can't believe you made it through this or made it through that." Evie, it's by the grace of God. Amen? It's by the grace of God. Because he talks to the doctors. He talks to the bill collectors. He talks to the mortgage companies. They may have an agenda, but God has the last say, the last word. But we've got to trust him for all of that. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's faith in God, not of ourselves, not anything we can do. You know why? Because it's the gift of God. It's the gift of God. In these strenuous times we're living in, we need to focus on God to get through. As I said earlier in this lesson, God protects his own. He takes care of his own for those who want to be taken care of by him. Verse 9, not of works, lest any man should boast. Nothing you can do, I can do to make it easier on God. And sometimes we think that he needs a co-pilot. I'll push that button over there, turn left, navigate a little bit to the right, drop down a little bit. Yeah. He doesn't need us. He's done it for all of these billions of years by himself. He doesn't need our assistance. Sometimes we think that God created us just to be his co-pilot. You think he's sitting in heaven going, man, I'm thankful that I thought to create you, because I couldn't have made it without you. Not so. Romans 4, verse 1. What shall we say then that Abraham our father, as pertaining to the flesh, had found? Verse 2. For if Abraham was justified by works, he hath whereof to glory. Now, if he was just into it for what he could do, and God wasn't in the picture, then he would be glorifying himself and telling everybody, look at me, ain't I the wisest one in the world? Come on and into my tribe. I'll give you the words that you need to hear. But not before God. He didn't go before God with that attitude. And the thing that you and I have to remember is, self-pride will get you fried. Did you hear me? Self-pride will get you fried. Because as I said before, you don't know what the end of the road is. There could be a brick wall there. There could be a dead end there. And if any of you do any traveling to any extent like I do, the GPS tells me, right down at the end of the road, make a right. I get down to the end of the road, there's a river. Done it before. But we have to depend on him, his grace, to carry us through. And the only way we do it is through communication, talking to him, helping him, his job be easier by listening. Romans chapter 4, verse 3. For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God and was counted unto him for righteousness. Now, whether you understand or remember the story of Abraham, Abraham was living in a country called Ur. Everything was going great. They worshiped idols. They worshiped anything that showed signs of a better life. And one day God spoke to him and said, Abraham, pack up your stuff and come and follow me, and I will make you a great person. I will make your seed great, great, great upon the land. He didn't talk to his family. He talked to him. And Abraham had that kind of faith. He just happened to have that kind of faith. And he said to God, okay. He told all of his close siblings what he was about to do, pack up if you want to go. And guess what? They packed up. And they left. And the Bible says, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. And you know what this segment shows you and I? You have to believe God for yourself. Lots of times we want to bring on a group of people with us, friends. Let me tell you something. If they don't believe, they may come along and just be the best sightseer you ever seen. Amen? And when you get in trouble, you need some encouragement. You turn around and you're like, where'd Johnny go? Where'd Sally go? They're headed on back to the hills. Because they never believed the first time. But your words were such encouraging, they wanted to go along to see what they might miss. But let me tell you something. On this journey, it takes faith. Grace comes by faith. And we have to hear the word of God and respond. John chapter 15, verse 15. Henceforth, I call you not servants. This is Jesus talking. Listen to this. Henceforth, I call you not servants, For the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. Now, meat on the bone. We're living here in the United States. The president is the president. Unto him we're the servants. Do we know what he's doing? Do we know what he's thinking? Do we know what he's going to say? Does he share it with us? No. Only what he wants to share. And we have to understand we are in a servant mentality. But Jesus said, I have called you friends. Friends, you are my friend. And why does he call us friends? For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. Hallelujah. He's made it known unto us. That's what makes us friends of God. He has not kept anything back from us. He has not kept anything away from us. But he has shared everything that is noted to be shared for us, that we may grow and understand and trust him. Because he's not in it for political publicity or political success. But he's in it to make sure his children, his friends, know who he is and what his motives are, that we someday may be with him. Whether it's his returning or whether we leave here by sickness or disease or whatever, the body dies. Everyone say the body dies. And the spirit goes back to the giver, the Father. So don't get too upset when you're standing before a funeral procession, the person you know is there. Don't get too upset. And especially if they were Christian, because you know what? They prepared for this day. Hallelujah. They prepared to be with the Lord. And I know we miss them, but don't get too upset or excited that they have left us, because they're going to a better place. They're up there rejoicing, kicking off their heels, dancing before the Lord. And we're down here saying, I wish you'd come back. Please don't go. And they're having a joyous time of their life. So the last scripture is Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, Paul writes to the church of Rome, therefore, being justified by faith, faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have it. We have it. And if any of us think that we don't have it, all we need to do is look up toward heaven, or bow down on your knees, or just sit and just say, Father, I need you in my life. I've went too far. And I'm asking you to come into my life and make all the crooked roads straight. I'm asking you, because I receive you as Lord and Savior. I want you to make a difference in my life, because up to now I've messed it up. You know what? It takes a real man of God and a real woman of God to be able to stand and say that to God. But he will make a difference in your life if you want him to, and if you let him. Father, we thank you for this sermon of grace, and we just bless your name and lift you up, and we just pray that this lecture here has been embedded in our minds and our souls to just think upon you more often than we do. And Father, we just give praise and honor to you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you once again for joining us at the Pastor.Faith YouTube channel. And we encourage you to continue to have a conversation with God on a daily basis. Not many people have the time or take the time to talk to him, but he wants to be your best friend. Also, continue to consider receiving him as Lord and Savior in your life, and allowing him to work a great peaceful work in your life, knowing that all things work together for the good to them that love God. Also, remember to continue to repent, confessing, asking forgiveness of all of our sins on a daily basis. And the most important thing is, after receiving Christ as Lord and Savior, is receiving His forgiveness in your heart. God bless you until next time.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But then things change and you're down in the valley. Listen, don't lose faith, for you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is your God in the valley. When things go wrong, you'll make them right. The God of the good time is still God in the bad time, the God of the day is still God in the night. Oh, you talk of faith. Talk comes so easy when life's at its best. Oh, but it's down in the valley of trials and temptations, 'cause that's where God in the night. Yes, the God.